about you guys, but I kind of like that intro. So if you're a first-time guest, you're the first guest in a while, first time you've been back in a while, welcome again. My name is Chris Sykes. If I didn't get to meet you earlier, I haven't gotten to shake your hand this morning. I'd love to get to meet you later, but you are brilliant. You're brilliant because you're here on Father's Day, so if you're a father, you're especially brilliant. But you're here on the day that we're going to give away a motorcycle, and I'm going to do that in just a couple of seconds. So that's brilliant, but you're also brilliant because you're here on the first day that we're launching our new summer series called Summer Swag. Everybody say swag. All right, we're going to talk about how you can have a little bit of swag, some spiritual swag, over the course of this summer. Everybody say stuff we all get. S-W-A-G, swag. What we're going to do, starting this morning, is we're going to take a look at the book of Matthew. So for the next, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 weeks, I haven't planned it all out yet, but for the next several weeks, we're going to be taking a look at the book of Matthew, and kind of as Christians, or those of you who are maybe exploring your faith, looking at the book of Matthew and saying, what is it that God promises us? How can we have some spiritual swag by walking with confidence in God? Because there's some stuff that we all get that God wants to give to us. How are y'all doing this morning? Good? Y'all doing pretty good? All right, good. So, let's think about Matthew chapter 1. Let's think about dads for a minute. We're going to get into Matthew chapter 1 and verse 18 in just a few minutes. But let's think about dads. Dads, have you ever felt pressure? Ever felt a little bit of stress? Probably so. Probably, maybe even this morning. Like, maybe you feel a little pressure this week, even though it's Father's Day, you know, like, that's supposed to be the day that, I don't know, maybe moms take care of us or our kids get us gifts. You may have felt pressure this morning getting up, getting ready to go to church. You know, maybe this is your first time in a long time, and you came because it's Father's Day, and maybe you feel a little stress, a little pressure from that. You know, maybe you were like me. I came in, and I got up extra early to be here early because that's what I do pretty much every Sunday. There's a little stress and pressure of just kind of making the service work. So maybe you're going to have lunch this afternoon, or family's coming over, and even though it's Father's Day, you're grilling out because you want to barbecue like a dad, and there's a little bit of stress and pressure. But look, there's tons of stuff that goes on in our lives that's a whole lot more stressful than that, for moms and for dads. But let's just, you know, for dads, like there's financial stress that we bear as fathers. We want to provide for our families. You know, and some of you moms, some of you single moms in the room that don't have a husband right now, we realize that you bear that burden as well. But you want to provide, but in providing financial support for your families, like there's even some stress from outside forces outside your family. You know, like you want to have a nice ride that your buddies are all jealous of. Like there's a little bit of stress and pressure for that, you know. You sometimes don't mind the $600 a month truck payment if it means that everybody's mouth's drooling when you drive by. Listen, my last car, I don't remember how many miles I put on it, but I started describing it as paint optional because all the paint was just, it was so cool, I was going so fast. Not really, it was a little four-door sedan, but just all the paint just wanted to slide right off of my car. So after I was just about driving the wheels off of it, I thought, I'm going to go buy a new car. I'd saved up money, I could pay half down, and I financed half for 3 years. I wanted to be smart, manage my finances as well. And we had a limited budget. I was looking at used cars, but not very old. And I kind of lucked up and got a new car. It's a Dodge Journey. Now, it's not necessarily the coolest car in the world, but you got to understand, I've got four kids. So I wanted something that was not a minivan. All right, you understand? Like, it didn't really matter as long as it had four wheels, it had good paint, and it was not a minivan. And I wanted a third row. So the Journey was the cheapest third row I could get. It gets okay gas mileage, not a whole lot of pickup, but it's new, it's got all its paint, and it's, repeat after me, or say it with me, not a minivan. First day with the new car, all my kids say, can we ride in your van with you, Daddy? I took it to a Dodge dealership. I promise you, I'd had it for about a month. There was a little something that needed to be fixed on it. I drove it into a Dodge dealership, parked it, got out, went in and talked to the person, you know, and the woman who was kind of in charge. She walks in front of the car, looks at it, looks down and says, so this is a Dodge Caravan, right? You work at the Dodge dealership. No, it's not a Caravan. This is not a, listen, that stress and pressure on me still exists, all right? I'm still driving the man van, all right? And I, That's all I can call it. It's a man band. The doors don't slide. But look, as dads, you know, we carry that, right? You know, if maybe you're a sports dad. You love sports and you've got some kids who play sports. And there's a certain pressure, like when your kids walk on the field, it's not pressure that you feel for them. I mean, you hope they succeed, right? But it's really so that you don't look bad as a dad. You know, like when it's your kid that loses the game.
It's not my kid. I'm just kidding. I'm always, whether my kids do great or not.
But there's a certain amount of pressure with that. And, you know, back to the finances. If your kids compete, or they do piano lessons, or they play in the band, or whatever it is. Like, I've got four, and I've got one who's a competitor. If any of your kids have ever played sports, if you've ever done any kind of travel sport or anything like that, like, just take your normal, like, if you've got the little 4 and 5 year old soccer season, and multiply that bill times 12 months, and then add some uniforms to that, and then add some travel expenses, like, that gets expensive. But you want your kids to, if that's something that they're good at, and they're passionate about, you want them to be able to perform in that. You want to give that to them. That's a certain amount of stress that maybe we place it on ourselves, but it's difficult. And sometimes in that stress and pressure, we lose a little bit of confidence, or maybe we even get too overconfident. But we're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. And there's a dad in the Bible who, without a doubt, he's one of those dads that we probably know the least about. But he might be, probably is, other than maybe Adam or maybe Abraham, right? The most important father figure in Scripture, who probably has the greatest amount of stress placed on him by God, all right? His stress is like a heavenly stress. I mean, imagine that. It's one thing for your wife to put stress on you. It's one thing for your kids to put stress on you. But God gives him a task to do that I've got to imagine he may have been afraid of. He may have even been tempted to say, you know, like, I'm the man, and get a little overconfident. So we're going to take a look at his story. If you want to read along with it, we're actually going to play a video this morning. As we go through these weeks, I've got the book of Matthew by video. So if you're in Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, you can read along or just watch the screen as the story unfolds for us.
This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
So, by the way, just a little side note, if you've got the Bible app on your phone and you've got that downloaded, those videos you can actually watch in the Bible app. There's a group right now called the Lumo Project, L-U-M-O. If you just Google Lumo Project, they're working on, I believe they've got all four Gospels
recorded in that kind of a quality. They're putting in them in multiple languages so they can be distributed all over the world. And you've got access to it in the Bible app. There's nothing like watching the Bible come to life. You can watch that with your family, watch it on your own. You could, I guess, read through the book of Matthew along with us as you're watching it come to life, because it's word for word with God's word as you watch that. So Lumo Project, the Bible app. But Joseph, right? The dad of the Savior of the world. Look, I'm a pretty proud daddy. I've got four great kids. I've got one who's super smart, like tests off the charts, loves video games, going to go to college early, I believe. Yeah, I've got one who's a gymnast who just flips and turns everywhere and, you know, takes home trophies and ribbons and medals all the time. I've got one who's just, I mean, she's just creative, and you never know what's going to come out of her mouth. And she makes us laugh, and that makes me proud. And then my youngest, I think he's smarter than everybody else. I mean, he's just like, and he's not even really started school yet, and he's already beginning to read. I mean, he's just a great kid. I'm proud. Man, think of Joseph. Think of how proud Joseph may have been to be the Savior of the world. But then think about, like, how scary that would be. The amount of stress and pressure. Those are the kinds of things that, while we may not be called to be the dad of the Savior of the world, but as sons and daughters, men and women, moms and dads, sons and daughters of God, sometimes we face some stress and pressure like that. And I want you to be able to walk out the door today with a certain amount of spiritual swag, understanding what it is, what that stuff is, the stuff that we all get from our Heavenly Father that Joseph got that allowed him to be a confident man of God. Because I can't help but read through those scriptures. Read through Matthew 1, 18 through 24, and see a certain godly confidence in Joseph that he had. And I want that. And I want that for you. So here's what I decided to do. I actually got this from a previous pastor of mine, this idea. I recreated it. But dads, I want to give you a spiritual swagometer. So let's get our summer swagometer up there. Okay, we've already got it up. So they beat me to it. All right, so we've got a swagometer or a swagometer. Now, as we look at the life of Joseph and we read about him and we think about ourselves, I think pretty much any situation that we get ourselves into, any circumstance that we walk into, like Joseph finding out that his bride-to-be is pregnant, and she's pregnant with the Savior of the world, there's probably a couple of different temptations that we face, right? And so one of those temptations is arrogance. It's pride. So let's throw that up there. Arrogance and pride. And here's, like for Joseph, just to know contextually what's probably going on in his life, even before he finds out anything's going on with Mary, that she's pregnant, more than likely, Joseph was probably a guy who wasn't much younger than me. He was probably around 30. We don't know. The Bible never tells us his age. But culturally, it was pretty typical for about a 30-year-old man to marry a younger woman. You know, 28, 32, to marry like a 14, 15, 16, 17-year-old. That was just a cultural norm. And so when he was engaged to Mary, we don't know how beautiful she was or her exact age, but just the fact that he got a wife might have caused him to have some pride and to say something like this: "Hey, I'm the man," right? "I'm the man." When we get arrogant, sometimes we say, "I'm the man." It's really easy in a situation to think that I got this, I can control this. And when Joseph finds out that Mary is pregnant, she's about to have a baby, he probably faced another challenge, another issue, and that's the other end of the spectrum. And that's fear. Oftentimes, when we walk into situations that we feel like we can't control, when we definitely don't feel like I'm the man, we're tempted to fear. It's just a natural reaction. And when that fear pops up, like certainly happened for Joseph, he probably thought, not I'm the man, but oh man, right? Oh man, like what happened? How did Mary get pregnant? I didn't know there were any other guys involved in her life. What's going on? But Joseph, he doesn't really respond with arrogance or with fear. Joseph responds in a way that this is what the Bible says about him. It's in verse number 19. It says that Joseph was a righteous man. There's something a little different about Joseph. That while I'm sure there may have been some pride in his life,
And there was probably certainly some fear in the circumstances. The way that he responded in the situation was from a position of righteousness, a position of being in right standing with God. And there's something that Joseph had because of that. And I think that's confidence. See, he decided to not hurt Mary, not to publicly shame her. There was probably community stress. His parents were probably furious. His friends around him were probably like, man, what's wrong with her? Like, you're the man, and you need to put her away. You need to get rid of her. I mean, he was in every right to publicly ridicule her, to literally drag her out in the street and potentially even like stone her, but to certainly have her cast out of their community, out of their neighborhood, out of their society. She would have been the laughingstock of everyone. And I'm sure when they found out, and they found out what Joseph was doing, which was taking her in as his wife anyway, they probably still ridiculed him, and there was a certain amount of stress. But here's what Joseph knew. When God spoke to Joseph, and I think even before God spoke to Joseph, when he made the decision to not put or to separate himself from her quietly, not publicly, there was something in Joseph then, and I think it's confirmed for Joseph when God speaks to him in the dream and the vision that he has, and it's this, that Joseph was God's man. You see, when we're tempted to show arrogance on the one hand, we say, I'm the man, right? I'm the man. I got this. I can control it. I can take care of it. And on the other hand, when we're tempted to fear in circumstances, and we say, oh man, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. Where do I go for help? Joseph's response is, I'm God's man. I'm going to do the right thing. I may not know all the answers, but I'm confident that God has this. And when God speaks to Joseph and he tells him what's going on, Joseph responds to God's commands. Joseph does exactly what God asks him to do. And he confirms for us, Joseph confirms for us, that he is a man of God. That's what I want for all of you dads this morning. That's what I want for all of you moms, all you teenagers, all you boys and girls, young men and young women. I want you to understand this morning how you can have the stuff we all get from God that Joseph got. It was this confidence in God. As a matter of fact, I don't think confidence is the right word. Let's take that one down and put up the other word. That is Godfidence. I think Joseph had this Godfidence that God had his back. I mean, clearly he was spoken to by God. And you may not have that situation going on in your life, and certainly we're not called to be the dads of the Savior of the world. But when you leave here this morning, my goal is that everyone in this room has a certain amount of spiritual swag, has a certain amount of confidence in who they are in Christ. And Joseph had that. That's the only way I think Joseph could have kept it all together. So there's three things that I want to point out to you, how you can know that you have some spiritual swag, that you can have confidence in God, Godfidence. The first thing that you need and that God wants to give you is that you need to be saved. You need to trust Jesus as your Savior. Now, if it's your first time here, you've probably not heard me say this before because it's your first time here. But if you've been here for a while, you've heard me say, look, you can come in. We are a place where no perfect people are allowed. You can come in regardless of your skin color, regardless of how much money you make or don't make. You can come in all messed up, jacked up, and shacked up, and we're still going to love on you, and you're welcome here. And you can belong here before you even believe what we believe. This is a safe place for you to explore your faith, for you to ask questions. This is a safe place for you to doubt God. And that's okay to a point. But there's a point at which if you want to be able to say, like Joseph, I'm a man of God. I'm a woman of God. I want all that stuff that we all get from God. The first step to do that is to trust Jesus as your Savior. You see, we all have sin in our lives. The Bible tells us that because we are in our sins, we're not perfect. None of us. I mean, there's no difference between me on stage and you sitting out there in our sins.
I'm not holier than you because I've got the microphone and I'm standing on stage. No, we're all sinners. And the Bible teaches us clearly that when we place our faith and trust in Jesus, the Son of Joseph, the Son of God, that God forgives our sins. You see, God requires a perfect sacrifice. In the Old Testament, they sacrificed it. If you've been in church, maybe you've heard this before, you've read it in your Bible, that in the Old Testament, they sacrificed things like sheep and lambs and birds, and they gave grain offerings. But every time they would sacrifice something, they would shed its blood, because the shedding of blood, it was through that shed blood of the innocent animal, the animal that didn't hurt anybody. You know, that animal didn't sin. It was a perfect, spotless lamb, and they would literally cut its throat and shed its blood. And the priest would do this for the people of God, the people of Israel. And it was through the shedding of that blood that when God looked down, he would see their sins forgiven because their sins were covered by the blood of the Lamb. None of us are perfect. We can't die for our own sins. We can't save ourselves. But when Jesus was born, like we saw in the video, the Son of God lived a perfect life. We believe that he lived for about 30 years. They took Jesus. They arrested him. They beat him. The one who was spotless and without blame, who didn't hurt anybody, who never sinned. And they nailed him to a cross. They put nails in his wrists and his feet. And he hung there and he bled. He shed his blood for the world. The Bible teaches us that God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son, that's Jesus. That when we place our faith and trust in him, he forgives us of our sins. Jesus became the perfect, once and for all time, Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And while you are always welcome to not believe what we believe, you can hear that, it can go in one ear and out the other. The moment that you say, you know what? I want what they've got. I want what Pastor Chris is talking about. I want what I've been learning about in my small group. I want some of that spiritual swag. The first step to do that is to simply say, God, forgive me of my sins. See, Romans teaches us that if we publicly confess with our mouth, if we say that Jesus is the Christ, that Jesus is our Messiah, he's our Savior, and we believe that in our hearts, then we are saved in that instant. It doesn't take magic words. It doesn't take you even walking to the front. Although I would encourage you, at the end of the service, we're going to sing a song. People are going to get up. They're going to come put their offering in the basket. And during that response time, I want to invite you, if you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior, come to the front. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about what your next steps are. I want to help you make sure that you have trusted Jesus as your Savior. But if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is the Christ and believe it in your heart, then you are saved. And to have that confidence, to have that spiritual swag, the stuff that we all get from God, you got to be saved. You got to be saved. Like Joseph, counted as a righteous man. And that's the cool part. Because men and women, when we trust Jesus as our Savior, even though we're still messed up, Like we still live in a messed up, broken world, even though you may still have broken relationships, your marriage with your spouse may be strained, your relationship with your kids, your relationship with your boss, your relationship with money and debt, all of that stuff may still be messed up. But when God sees you, he sees you as a righteous son or daughter of him, of his. That's amazing. So that's the first thing that we all get, is we get forgiveness when we are saved. The second thing I want to tell you about Joseph and how we can have kind of this confidence is that you're called. You are called. That's something that we all get. We all get called. When you trust Jesus as your Savior and you get saved, you also get called. You may not realize it, but I know, like in the American church, we talk about, and churches around the world, we talk about pastors or missionaries being called into ministry. And yes, there is some sense where I've been called to be the pastor of this church. There's certainly a sense where I'm called. But the calling doesn't just come to me. The calling to minister to the world, the call for us
to be pastors and shepherds to the world around us, to share the gospel with the world around us, doesn't just come to pastors. It doesn't just come to missionaries. As a matter of fact, in 1 Peter 2, chapter 2, verse 9, it says this, "But you are not like that, for you are a chosen people." All right, we're talking to the church here, people who are saved. God says, you are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness into a wonderful light. Listen, if you're saved, you're a priest. You are part of the royal priesthood. The only difference between you sitting out there and me standing up here in our calling is that I'm one of the lucky 2% of Christians around the world who gets paid to do what everybody else should be doing. I don't know if you ever thought about it that way. But I'm one of the very, very, I thank God every day, one of the very most fortunate 2% of Christians in the world, maybe 2%, who gets paid to do what every other Christian ought to be doing. And that's preaching and teaching the Word of God. That's sharing the love of God with the world around us. The same call that's on my life. Now, somebody along the way said, okay, let's take Chris and let's kind of put him in charge of everything. Whoever had that idea may have been just a little, you know, I'm not sure if they were led by God or not. I'm just kidding. But, I mean, that's the only difference, is that I'm kind of in charge, and I'm not even in charge all by myself, right? I mean, there are people, great men and women around me, who help me make decisions and help me lead our church. But the calling on my life to share the gospel is the same calling that's on your life. That's one of the things that you get. You see, Joseph was called to be the father of the Savior of the world. Huge calling. I mean, he's not the biological daddy, right? But he gets to be kind of the baby daddy, all right? He is called to be the father of the Savior of the world. That's not going to be the same calling on your life. That's not going to be the way that God is going to use you. You see, God uniquely gifted Joseph to be able to handle that. But God has uniquely gifted you as well. If you've trusted Jesus as your Savior, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit indwells you, that you, like at birth, God gave you certain talents, certain natural abilities, but when you are reborn, when you're saved at that spiritual birth, God gives you certain spiritual gifts. And he takes those talents, and he takes those spiritual gifts, and in only a way that God can, he puts all that together inside you, and you are uniquely gifted to play an important role in the life of this church and in the life of the body of Christ. We are described as being one body. That's the church universal. Every Christian in the world, we're one body with many parts. And all of you have a part to play. And the Bible says that every part is important because when one part hurts, the whole body hurts. I also believe that when one part is successful, the whole body is successful. And we have to wake up as a church and realize that we are called by God. We're saved by God's grace, and we're called by God to share his word. You have a calling on your life, just like Joseph did. And the third thing is this. Not only are we saved and we're called, but God gives us a purpose. You see, there's something powerful about when a saved person realizes that they're called, and then God puts purpose in their life, kind of gives them marching orders, something exactly suited for them that they're supposed to do. And you all have a unique purpose. Just like you have a unique calling, you have a unique purpose, but we also have a universal purpose that we all share. You see, there's a mistake sometimes that we make because we get maybe a little arrogant, or maybe we have a little bit of fear. I think this probably comes over on the arrogant side. And that's this. There's this temptation that we all have where we get saved, we trust Jesus as our Savior. We come to church, we tithe, you know, we do all that kind of stuff. And then we get this great idea, and we say, for our families, for our church, whatever, but we get this great idea, and we start praying, and this is kind of how the prayer goes, although not exactly like this. God, I've got this dream for the future. I've got this
this vision. I've got this plan. I've got this idea. I've got this purpose that I want to live for. And God, will you bless it? God, will you be on my side? God, will you make my purposes your purposes? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We'll pray prayers like that, where we ask God to join our plans. How arrogant is that? And good men and good women, we do that all the time. But listen, God has a purpose for you. Our prayer should not be, God, will you make my plans your plans? No, our prayer should be, God, will you make your plans my plans? God, begin to change my heart so that I can see the work that you're doing and go and do that work. Like Joseph, he hears a voice from God. God says, go and do this. And Joseph doesn't say, well, God, I don't really want to do it your way. I've got this other plan. Can we do it my way? No, he says, okay, God, I'm going to do it your way. As men and women of God who are walking in confidence, God has given us all a purpose. Dads, your purpose in life is more than just protecting your kids, providing for your family. Those are both great things, and you should all do that. But it's more than just waking up in the morning, going to work, getting a paycheck, coming home, eating dinner, going to bed, getting up the next morning, going to work, earning a paycheck, coming home, eating dinner, going to bed. Your life can have so much more impact than just providing for your family, protecting your wife and kids. The purpose for your life is proclamation. It's to proclaim your aim. What God has called us to do, all men and women, Matthew 28, 19, and 20 teaches us to go and share the gospel, to take Jesus to the nations. Our purpose in life as men and women of God is to proclaim Jesus, is to proclaim the aim of our lives. And here's what I mean by proclaim the aim of our lives. Dads, if you're driving the car, who's driving the car? It's not a trick question. You are. Okay, Dad, stay with me. All right, I know I kind of threw you off with that one. Dads, if you take your hands off the steering wheel, who's driving the car? Nobody. But you are. You're still responsible for it. If you're in the driver's seat and your foot's still on the gas, like, you're still responsible for where that car is going. You've aimed it in a direction. A lot of times as dads, we get tempted to take our hands off the steering wheel. There are some moms who've been leaning over into our seats and trying to drive the car for us. But look, whichever direction the car is going, if you are a dad, and moms, I don't mean this as disrespectful to you at all, especially if you're a single mom, but dads, if you are a dad, God has called you to drive the car of your family. He put you in charge for a reason. He created you that way. That doesn't mean that you lord it over your family. That doesn't mean you force your wife or your kids to submit to your will because you're in charge. But you have the responsibility to aim the car that your family, the car that your family is driving in toward God. Your proclamation about your family should be the aim that your the direction that your car is aimed in should be this. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. It's Joshua. As for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. That's the aim of your life that God has called you to. That's the purpose of your life as a dad. Moms and non-moms and non-dads, men and women, you're not off the hook because that's the aim of all of our lives. That's the purpose that we all share, is to aim ourselves toward God, drive the car in His direction, and stop and pick up as many strangers along the way as we can. We're supposed to proclaim our aim to everybody and drive the man van with the third row. All right? Like get the, we want to borrow like the Palmer Home van, right? That holds like 18 kids in the back. That's the kind of spiritual family that God has given us the purpose to grow as we grow His kingdom. So here's the deal. If you don't feel like you've got confidence, that little bit of spiritual swagger, maybe you've got a little bit of fear in your life, maybe there's a little bit of arrogance where you just feel like you can control it all and you don't want to give up control to God. God's message for you this morning is,
Have you trusted me? Have you trusted me to forgive you of your sins? If not, the first thing you need to do is be saved. And if you are saved, do you understand that you are called? That I call you my children. I've called you my son, my daughter. You're a part of my family now. That means that I love you. That means that my spirit lives in you. As a matter of fact, 2 Timothy says that we've not been given a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. And my dad's in the room, and I want to ask him, like in the original Greek that was written in, the word power, I believe in the original Greek, that's the word swag, right? Yeah, see, he agrees with me. Everybody say swag. Swag. God gave you a spirit of swag. It's actually dynamite, dunamos. But anyway, I don't know any Greek whatsoever, so it's swag. Seriously. God wants to give you that spirit of swag. You just have to realize that you've already got it. And then the last thing is realize what your purpose is. God's message to you this morning is proclaim me. Love me and proclaim me, proclaim my son. You've already declared it once if you're saved. You've already said Jesus is the Savior of the world. He just wants you to keep repeating yourself. Jesus is the Savior of the world. Share that with everybody you come in contact with.